Hello Internet, this is Oscar Release. In this video, we'll be going over how to generalize finite difference method to solve systems of nonlinear equations. We'll talk about the Jacobian, go through some examples, and then have some discussion. It is recommended that you have some background on finite difference method as well as Newton's method for systems of nonlinear equations. Let's again use this nonlinear system example of x squared minus y equal to 1 and x minus y squared equal to negative 1 with these four solutions. This slide should look familiar to those who've seen my earlier video on Newton's method for nonlinear systems, where I evaluate the Jacobian at 1, 1. But what is the Jacobian? The technical definition is that it is the partial derivatives of every variable in f against every function in f, but that definition isn't very useful. A better question to ask is, what does the Jacobian do? And for that, it describes how a local change to the input changes the output of our function. As an example, let's make a small change to our input going a little bit to the right of 1, 1. What is the change to our output going to look like? When we multiply our Jacobian times our small change to the input, we get an output change expected of 0.2, 0.1, looking something like this. This says our expected output is going to be around negative 0.8 and 1.1. If we actually plugged in that value into our function, we get an output of negative 0.79 and 1.1, very close. The same is true if we make a small change in the y direction. Using our Jacobian in that y change, we get an output change of negative 0.1 and negative 0.2, giving a result of around negative 1.1 and 0.8. The actual answer, negative 1.1 and 0.79. which looks like that. This means that if we know the Jacobian and our change to the input, we can predict our change to the output. What if instead we use our input and output changes? From those, we can actually figure out our Jacobian. By taking the difference between our actual change to the output and our function at that point, this gives us these values. We can use them to try to figure out the Jacobian. Do you see it yet? Maybe this will help. Let's divide those changes by our actual step size change, giving us these numbers. Do you see it yet? What about now? Using our finite differences, we can estimate our Jacobian value. That is the basis of finite difference method. But why does this work? Let's take a step back and look at what a derivative actually is, given by the limit of this finite difference. The same is true for partial derivatives, meaning what we've done is taken the finite difference to compute an approximation to the Jacobian as h gets small. This was the finite difference approximation we actually used, but let's generalize it a little bit to instead replace those changes of 0.1 to just simply be h. Then, if we look closer at what those are doing, we're simply adding h to x for the first two equations and adding h to y for the second two. If we expand things out, this is our Jacobian, essentially, taking the finite differences to approximate our derivative of f. Let's let capital H be little h times the identity, giving something that looks like this. It's useful in this kind of equation to give a more formal explanation of the Jacobian. It actually expands to something like this, but is shortened in the other equation. Then we just apply Newton's method. Let's let little h be the value of 0.1, giving capital H to be this matrix. Plug that into our equation for the Jacobian, and we get this guy, which we've already seen. We'll then use this Jacobian approximation in our Newton's method as normal, giving our estimated value for x1 to be 1.90 repeating, 1.90 repeating. Plot it right there and evaluate it closer to 0. We then use x1 in our new estimation for the Jacobian giving this solution, which when plugged into Newton's method as before, gives our next value for x2 to be 1.657, 1.657. When we plot that value, we get a number that is very close to zero. We'll keep repeating this process with Newton's method until our change in step size becomes less than some epsilon, reach some small enough point, or a maximum number of iterations. Let's look at a numeric example, starting from the point 1, 2, with the value of h of 0.1. These are the first several iterations of finite difference method, and the Jacobian that we approximate using that method. Let's compare that to the actual Jacobian. Notice that for every step, we get something that's actually very close. If we compare that to the Jacobian approximation from Stephenson's method, I'll put a card to that video if you're interested. Notice that Stephenson doesn't do a very good job approximating for the first two iterations, but once we start to get close, it's actually very good. In fact, it's even better than finite difference method. Is there a way to improve the accuracy of finite difference method? There is. Notice that the value used for h was 0.1. What if we change that? Here's the same example, but only looking at the point 1.62, 1.62. As we use smaller and smaller values for h, we get much more accurate to the Jacobian at that point. It's even better than Stephenson's method. This works, again, because with partial derivatives, they get better as h approaches zero. Just a little more on Stephenson's and finite difference. They use different values for the capital H, but the methods they use are very close. In fact, if we multiply finite difference by the identity, we can actually use capital H by multiplying little h inverse against the identity, giving the same equation. Meaning the only difference between the two is what we use for capital H. The same thing is true even when finding roots of equations using finite difference method and Stephenson's method. We can let h be the value of f of x in finite difference method to give us Stephenson's. The same is true for nonlinear systems. Both of these methods require a lot of function calls per iteration, meaning it's actually very expensive for them to compute the Jacobian. We also never reuse those function calls. The difference with finite difference is that when h is small, we get something that's much more accurate, and we have a constant value for h rather than an updating one. Important notes from this video are that we can approximate the solutions to systems of nonlinear equations with the quadratic order by approximating the Jacobian using finite differences. With a small value for h, it's much more accurate, and it does require a lot of function calls to compute this, but it is better than Stephenson's method when h is small. For a much more efficient way to update the Jacobian, see Broyden's method, which will be the next video in this series. For a method that doesn't use the Jacobian at all, check out generalized secant method, which I already have a video on. The code that I wrote for this lesson will be hosted on GitHub. For more insight into the Jacobian, I recommend checking out a video by a friend of the channel, Mathemaniac, called What is Jacobian? As always, thank you for watching. Please let me know your thoughts on this lesson in the comments below. If you want to see when the video on Broyden's method comes out, definitely subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications so you can get an alert. Again, thank you for watching.